Okay, let's start. Hello everybody. In this talk I'm going to illustrate how to manage your DNS infrastructure as code and also how this problem came out and the step to solve it. First, a little word about me. I'm Matteo Valentini, a software developer for an Italian company called Netesis. Mostly do infrastructure development. This is my contact in case you want to reach me later. First of all, why this problem came out? Allora, all the management of DNS infrastructure in my company was based on web interface. It was a point and click. We don't know who made the change, why made the change. It's a little mess. And it was assigned to me, the task to upgrade our management from a web console to something modern. Can be on-premise, on the cloud, I can choose wherever I want. Some constraint, one day for production, so this must be done in one day, and the solution must be programmable and or versionable. After some thinking, I came out with a solution. I think about the on-premise solution, can be more complex to manage in the future, and have a high learning steep. The cloud solutions is have so many vendors to choose. I don't know what choose. And I came out with a hybrid solution where I can manage locally my configuration, but I can choose any provider. And the solution was Okta DNS. Why Okta DNS? It's because mostly it's a file-based configuration, so you can easily manage via CVS. Support multiple providers, so you don't choose one provider. It's a provider agnostic, so you can use the same configuration file between different providers. Let's talk a bit about Okta DNS. It's created by GitHub and used internally as for manage their infrastructure. And eventually released as open source project, as you can see in their Git log. Is a YAML configuration base. Okay, let's say a simple configuration. We have a list of supported providers that we define. The first one is a YAML provider where we tell to Okta DNS where to find our zone configuration. The second one is the type of DigitalOcean, that is a cloud provider that we are going to use. And the important parameter is token, where we tell to Okta DNS where to find the credential for access to this provider. Here we have the zone definition. We have a source, is a list of providers where Okta DNS are going to read the zone configuration. And target, is a list of target providers where Okta DNS are going to apply the configuration. Okay. This is an example of a zone configuration. We have a root record and a list of type associated with that record. And below we have a www record where we can specify the type of record, the TTL, etc. We are going to see the usage of Okta DNS. You can easily install via pip. With Okta DNS validate, you can have a syntax validation of your configuration. With Okta DNS sync, you can test your modification of your zone. With Okta DNS, with the parameter do it, you actually apply your modification. This is the layout of our directory with the configuration, the directory zone where reside the actual zone configuration. So, as I told before, one of the key features was file-based configuration, so we can use Git for manage our configuration. Let's see what are the benefits of using Git. One of the benefits is you have an history of DNS change. You can see when the change was made. You can relatively easy roll back in case of error. you can add, most importantly, who make the modification and why. And I add when. Another thing that is can facilitate the review process between peers, so you can ask for review to your colleague before applying the modification, and everybody know who do what. So, let's talk about privacy. Because I talk about privacy, because manage manually all the zone change can be annoying and error prone. So, let's automate all the projects with privacy. Privacy start to listen to all events of a repository and can do action based off of a configuration file. Let's see the configuration file. Let's see what is the benefit of automation. We can have, as I told before, a continuous integration, so we can run a test, a validation test for every change, in our case, for every pull request. We can continuous deployment, so we can apply the change automatically every time we merge the change proposed to our master branch. And we can avoid a leak of credentials, because who will eventually make the modification will not be the user, but privacy. So we can not tell to user our security credentials. Personally, I don't know the security credentials we use in my company. Let's see some configuration. This is the main configuration file of privacy. This it must reside in your root of your Git repository. The important part are script. That is the step that privacy will execute when someone make a pull request, and deploy section where we tell to privacy what to do when we actually merge the modification. We can see when someone propose modification, we do a validation of the syntax, a test of the change, and when we merge to master, actually do the change. Okay. And another important thing is, is the privacy permit to define some environment variables. In this case, we have defined the DO token that will contain our secure credential to provider. We have made this variable as secure, so will be not accessible to the untrusted build, like the pull request from another repository. Let's see. Okay. Let's see the resulting workflow. Let's see. An user make a pull request with the change. Privacy test the change. A user ask for review for the pull request. So I made this change, tell me is it done, is it correctly. After an administrator start the review, let me see, the administrator can approve the review if I think it's correct. Then the user merge the pull request. So it's not the administrator that apply actually the change, but it's the user that merge the pull request when he think is correct to do. And in the end, privacy apply the request of the change. Okay. Let's see what are other benefit of using Okta DNS. As was told in the talk before, we have the problem of multi-vendor. This can help to solve the problem because you can easily have multiple provider setup. For example, this configuration, we add another provider, in this case Cloudflare, and we just add the new provider in the list of the target provider. So every time we apply the modification of our zone from config provider, it will be eventually replicating this awesome provider and Cloudflare provider. We actually use this configuration in our company. we don't have configured the NS record of our zone for point to Cloudflare, but we can do if there are some problem, we easily change the configuration and we have a downtime of 30 minutes, but for us it's tolerated. Another feature of Octodynes, you can easily copy two zones from one provider to another. How? In this way, you add from the source section the DigitalOcean provider and target the Cloudflare provider. So when you will invoke Octodynes, it will copy the configuration from DigitalOcean to Cloudflare. You have to do nothing. Okay, so some quick and recommendation that I can give you in case do you want to deploy this solution. As I told you before, the Travis C secure variable are not available for pull request from another repository, and in our case we do a lot of fork and pull request workflow. So every time that a user will make a pull request, this build failed. For avoid this, we can put an if where we check if Travis secure variables are present. If are not present, we skip. So here we skip the test step because we don't actually test the configuration, we don't actually have access to configuration for our provider. In this case, we can skip also, we have empty config environment variable, so the Octodynes validate syntax will not fail because when he validated the syntax of the configuration, want to access also to the environment variable. Another recommendation that I want to give you is to protect the master branch. You can write in the master branch only via pull request. Make it mandatory for the pull request to be up to date with the master branch before merge, so you always test the state that will be eventually. And this is a thing that we use is to block the merge of the pull request when if almost one person approves the pull request. So in the end of the day, for me, was mission accomplished. We moved from a based point and click configuration to something more structured in the infrastructure as code paradigm. The DNS management are now versionable and start in the morning and production in the late afternoon. Not that day, but the day tomorrow, the day after, because we have make sure that all changes are reported correctly. So it's all for now.
Thank you for the. Can you hear me?
The microphone is for the people at home.
Oh, sorry. Thank you for the talk. Do you know if it has any support to find misconfiguration? Let's say suddenly someone still has access to the DigitalOcean dashboard modified.
Yes.
Does it alert you from somehow or just willing?
No, simply, Laura, he don't have any alerting system for this, but simply he overwrite every configuration that is not in the YAML file. So if you go manually in the DigitalOcean dashboard and add a record, and after you invoke OctoDNS, that record will be deleted. Because OctoDNS can know if the record is here because you add the manually, or it was here because you delete from the configuration. so it mirrors the local configuration.
But does it have a way of alerting you before,
no.
I want to run every hour and check?
No.
Okay.
No. Because it's, he can know.
Can I use OctoDNS also like to import my old standard zone files into the YAML format? Like saying source is like the real bind zone file. And destination is like a YAML file?
I think so that the other you way can. Around. I don't know exactly, but OctoDNS, if I remember correct, can have also bind as a source provider or there's some other file format, but I'm not sure right now is the correct answer.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Any other questions?
So when you have multiple downstream providers, how do you ensure that a configuration is deployed on both?
So
if one of them fails, what happens then?
In this case,
and how do you keep them in sync after that?
In this case, the OctoDNS command will fail. Simply, if one of the target provider will be down or some other problem. I think it not will revert to the other provider. I think it will simply apply the change to the first one provider, and the second fade, the second will remain in erroneous state. It's not so evolved.
You're asking for cross-environment transactions.
Yes.
These are an unsolved problem in computer science. Anybody else? No. Oh. It's unplugged, sorry. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.